I want to still give you a bit of a feeling and come back to what we discussed in the very beginning of this lecture. In the very beginning, we had these examples and said, well, here's a set of points, here are two functions, which maybe might be a better function to learn this particular data set. And we discussed that Occam's razor is something that at least many people state is a useful thing to look at. And now I want to relate this back to learning theory and want to see whether learning theory now says we should follow Occam's razor or not. So here's what we did. I think it was the first or second lecture in this term. We had these couple of data points, the black ones. We guessed two different ways to fit this data. This red line here was guess one, and this red line here is guess two. And the question was, which of the two functions should be preferred? And then the argument was always, well, if I don't have any additional prior knowledge, maybe the first function might be a bit better. It doesn't make so many funny things. So the second guess, I mean, there are all these wiggles in the functions, and unless I have a good reason to believe that these wiggles are there, why shouldn't I simply use the linear function? Because it seems to be easier. And this principle that you should look for simple functions, this is called Occam's razor. And often also the principle of parsimony, if you like. And what you read often in textbooks and so on, or in Wikipedia, wherever you look it up, it says something like, when you choose from a set of otherwise equivalent models, the simpler model should be preferred. You should always use a linear function unless you have a good reason to use a polynomial function with a higher degree. And the intuitive argument that you then always read that tries to justify these things is something along the following line. Occam's razor helps us to shave off those concepts, variables or constructs that are not really needed to explain the phenomenon. By doing that, developing the model will become easier and there's less chance of introducing inconsistencies, ambiguities and redundancies. Okay? And all this, of course, makes perfect sense from a high level point of view. But now I want to come back and ask, well, is this really what learning theory tells us? So in learning theory, the main message was we look at the size of this function space. Nowhere in these generalization bounds we looked at something like, is a function simple or complex, or does my space contain simple or complex functions? It didn't matter. If I have a function space consisting of 10 functions, it's not about whether these functions are simple or not. I simply need to count these functions and maybe might need to find out how many different labelings can I realize with these functions. But it's not about whether this is a simple function or not, whether it's a polynomial function with a small degree or a high degree. And now the question is whether there's a contradiction or whether it's sort of, maybe it's just two different ways to look at the same thing. And that's really the question. And here I would like to ask you and maybe really ask you to lean back and take a couple of minutes and think about it. So do you think that what we have proved in learning theory is a contradiction to Occam's razor? Or is it not a contradiction? And no matter what you think, try to find a good justification for it. And please do it for now, and then you switch off the video, and then you come back after a couple of minutes. I want to offer you two explanations. The first point of view that you could come up with is you could say, well, it's really not about simplicity. And this is what I essentially already mentioned. So consider an example where you have a function class that contains 10 simple functions and 10 very complicated functions. For the estimation error, it doesn't really make a big difference. So we don't really need the fact that functions are simple if we just want to prove, for example, a generalization bound. So here it seems that simplicity is maybe not really what we're looking for, right? And this is the one point of view. Now here's the other point of view. This is sort of the point of view that might reconcile these two different approaches. In fact, it is true that points that consist of many simple functions have typically are smaller than function spaces that consist of many complicated functions. And I want to illustrate this, maybe just give the intuition with sequences of, like, assume we have, say, in a very simplistic setting, we just have 10 data points and our functions just are binary labelings, plus one, minus one, plus one, minus one. So our function space in principle consists of 2^n many functions. And now, okay, so just a finite function space. And now, when would we call these functions simple and when would we call these functions complex? Typically, we would call this function simple if there's an easy to describe pattern by which we can describe how this function looks like. For example, you could say all the first couple of points are zero and then the other couple of points are all plus one. Or you have some way to describe the simplicity of a function space. And this is intuitively, and then, okay, sorry, the other way around, if you have a completely, like if you toss some coins and then you assign your function labels according to the coin tosses, probably there's no underlying pattern that you could exploit to describe these functions. This would be a complex function. And now if you know a bit about data compression, this is really the point of data compression, that like you could say a sequence of labels is simple if I can describe it in an easy way. This means I can compress it. I can, instead of just like if a sequence is hard to compress, I essentially need to write out what is the function on each particular point. But I might compress it and express it much easier if I could just say the first 5 points are zero and the next 5 points are one. And in this sense, it is true that if you have a function class that can be described by a small number of parameters, this function class tends to be small. So, and the other way around, if you have functions that are simple in the way that is meant by Occam's razor, say a polynomial of a small degree, then the function space associated with the space tends to be small. Because if it would be too complex, we wouldn't be able to describe it in such a simple way. And here is again one more example in terms of polynomials. So assume we have polynomials in one variable and we have just a discrete set of coefficients. So our functions look like sum over ak x to the power of k. And say these coefficients are just finitely many, just for simplicity. So if we look at degree one, we just have 200 such polynomials. Because k is 1, or d here is 1, so we just have it in one power, and then we have just 200 choices, like these ak come from a space that is size 200, so we have 200 choices for ak, and that's it. Now if our polynomial has, degree 2, we already have 200 to the power of 2 many choices, because we will have 2 parameters to pick. And if the degree increases, we have more and more parameters. And so we see that the number of functions in our space, at least in this particular example, grows quite dramatically with the complexity, if you would like. So the space of polynomials of degree 1 linear functions is much smaller than the space, say, of polynomials of degree 5. And now this is sort of the slide about compression. I already made the example, but maybe let's look again on the space, on the slide. A space with few functions can be represented with few bits. So maybe it's just a lookup table. So if you have 5 functions, you can just write down the lookup table, what does this function do? Now if you have a space that has simple functions, you can also represent it with few bits, for example, by just encoding one parameter. And if you have a space of complex functions, the function can do everything on all particular data points, like you can have arbitrary labelings of your data points wherever they sit, then you cannot compress this function space and you have much, much, much more elements in your function space. I mean, this is of course an intuitive argument, but you can of course make this more precise. I simply don't want to do it here, but this is just to reconcile Occam's razor and learning theory. So what we now can say, or what is the intuitive conclusion we can draw? Spaces of simple functions are small. Spaces of complex functions tend to be large. Of course, I can still construct a space consisting of 10 functions which are very complex, but at least typically you don't just pick 5 complex functions, but you have a full space full of complex functions, and then the space tends to be large. Now, learning theory tells us that we should prefer small function spaces, at least if we want to get the estimation error small. And I think this is sort of the key reason, the key sentence on the set, on the slide. This often leads to spaces of simple functions. So if you try to look at spaces of functions that would occur in practice, like linear functions, polynomials, kernel functions, then these spaces tend to be small if the functions that you're looking at are simple in the other way around. And so in this case, somehow Occam's razor and learning theory are nearly the same. And you can, if you want, there's a whole branch of learning theory that builds on this compression kind of principle, and that's the principle of minimum description length. That was also quite popular maybe 10 years ago. So there's a whole book in this field by Peter Grünwald from Amsterdam. And now what is the bottom line? How can we now compare Occam's razor and learning theory? So I think, the quantity that controls generalization is not so, it's not really the simplicity. It's not directly the simplicity of a function. It is the size of the function space. But spaces of simple functions tend to be small, and then these spaces are good candidates for learning. So the way I like to summarize this is Occam's razor slightly misses the point. I mean, it nearly got it right. It said, well, we need to look at spaces of simple functions. And learning theory says, yes, that's fine, but the reason is not that the functions are simple and that you shave off all these concepts that maybe are unnecessary and so on, but the reason is more hidden in these statistical principles here. And these spaces of simple functions are also functions that learning theory would consider good. So in this sense, Occam's razor is maybe not the principle that makes it correct, but when Occam's razor is true, or when spaces of functions are simple, then they tend to generalize good. So in this sense, Occam's razor is maybe like a first approximation of what is really the ground truth. And I mean, you need to remember Occam. I think he was a monk in 1200 or so. So this is already nearly 1,000 years ago. Well, maybe I'm wrong. In fact, I don't know. Maybe it was also 400 years later. Don't pin me down here. But I mean, this has definitely been stated much before anything about statistics or scientific principles has been known. So I think it is a very good first proxy, but from a learning theory point of view, it is just not the right thing, but very close to the correct thing. Now, this is sort of the end of the learning theory chapter. Maybe let's briefly talk about the outlook. So obviously, we have only scratched the surface. I mean, you could have whole lectures on learning theory. There are conferences on learning theory. And we just looked at the very classic regime, binary classification, for some of the algorithms, like support vector machines or so, that are out there. Now, the one big thing that this part of learning theory cannot describe is why deep networks work. And this has been and is still puzzling for many people in learning theory. So, it was around 2012, 13, 14, 15 when it became apparent how good neural networks really are. And also that the standard learning theory cannot be applied to these types of algorithms. And I have a couple of reasons on this slide. And again, I mean, I just have two slides on this topic. You can fill another lecture on what's going on in this field currently, but I just want to give you some outlook. So what you can prove is that the function class that is induced by a deep network has a very high capacity. So if you try to compute the shattering coefficient of a deep network, it's always going to be 2 to the power of n. You can train a neural, like, and saying it the other way around, you can train a neural network in such a way, given, say, some images, you assign random labels to your images, and you can train the neural network to perfectly fit these random images. And this has, in fact, also been done, I think, in 2017 or so. There was this paper, I believe, by Joshua Bengio and some other authors who really showed that, and it was called, like, we need new tools in learning theory, because look, deep neural networks, they can fit all labelings that I will put on a data set. So this was the empirical proof for something that has also been proved theoretically, that the capacity of the function class that is behind a neural network is so large that all the standard learning theory bounds do not tell us are trivial. So they're not going to converge to zero. In particular, the deep neural networks also in practice are trained to overfit the data completely. So it's not like what you would do in early days of machine learning. You might even early stop your algorithm. I mean, even if your algorithm has already all the training labels correct, you might still continue to train your algorithm. And apparently performance still increases. So we from the learning theory point of view, we completely do the wrong thing. We overfit particularly on this one particular data set. But still, these deep neural networks are really good, and in many, many cases they do generalize very well. So the question is really what goes on here. The one remark I want to make is it does not mean that the standard learning theory is wrong. It just means that the tools that we have for standard learning theory are not the right tools to explain why deep networks work. If you try to apply the tools of learning theory to deep networks, they get trivial bounds. So if you have this kind of generalization bounds, the bound is never going to go to zero. However, it's not going to tell you that it can't be true that neural networks work. You just need to have a different toolbox. And now, I mean, since the last 5 or so years, many people in learning theory are working in this field. It's a very widely open field. How can you prove from a theoretical point of view what is the learning theory that you need to prove why or to understand why deep neural networks work? And this is really, I think it's not so much because people like so much proving theorems. There's a very fundamental question here. And understanding the principles that lead neural networks to learn might have many positive impacts. It might show us, first of all, in which cases do they learn, maybe in which cases do they not learn. Maybe we can simplify neural networks again once we know what is really the key criterion that makes these things learn. Maybe we don't need this very complicated architecture, maybe something else follows a similar principle but would be much simpler to implement and so on. So it's many, many people try to understand that. And I think the consensus in many of these, there is no solution yet. So this is really a field of research that is widely open, at least in this year, 2020. Might be that someone finds a breakthrough in the next year, but right now it's still open. I think one of the key beliefs that are out there in the field is that there needs to be, that the way we optimize these algorithms, like the stochastic gradient descent, for example, has a big aspect in the fact why neural networks work or don't work. There are many interesting results out there. For example, there are lots of results that say under certain circumstances, maybe there are not even so many local optima, or each local optimum is already a global optimum, so that might explain why neural networks, in terms of stochastic gradient descent, don't end up in a local optimum, but in a very good, potentially global optimum. There are also points of view more from a statistical side, and I just want to give you one teaser. Out of one paper that I like, and this is the paper by Misha Belkin and some other co-authors in PNAS last year, and where they talk about the double descent curve. And I briefly want to explain simply the key idea of this paper. I have the figure here. So on the left side here, you see a figure that, like the ones we had in the beginning of the lecture, on the x-axis you have the capacity of your function space. So how large is your function class? And on the y-axis you have the true error, the risk, the true underlying test error. And then typically what we said also in the beginning of our lecture, I mean, it's exactly this kind of plot. You have this kind of U-shaped curve where you say, well, in the beginning, if the function space is too small, you severely underfit because your function class doesn't even have the potential to fit your data. If you increase the size of your function class, it gets better because you can have a smaller approximation error. And then eventually it's going to increase again because your estimation error gets larger, because you have the potential to overfit your data so strongly that in the end you're not going to generalize. So this is the traditional view of machine learning theory. And maybe also here the dashed line is the training risk, like if you train a classifier, of course you can train more and more and you get a smaller training error and it gets smaller and smaller the higher my function class is. And the trick is somehow you can't train until you have training error zero, because then you're already in this regime where you're overfitting. So you need to stop at some point before, and sort of the secret is always what is a good point to stop. So this is the traditional point of view, and here's now the new point of view. So now what happens is, on the left part of this plot, we have exactly the same plot as before. But now we see what continues if we keep on training our network, if we keep on increasing the function class. And then the observation is, and this is first of all an empirical observation, that what happens is, I mean, we first have this U-shape, but then there's a certain point where if you keep on training your networks, like, and this is for example true for neural networks, if you keep on training, you overfit more and more, and then all of a sudden the test error goes down again. And this is the thing that is really completely unexpected. Like in learning theory you would have said, well, this simply increases monotonically as long as you want to draw your x-axis. What you observe in practice is now, well, it's not true. This is now called the double descent curve. That has also been described in a couple of papers, but in particular in the one that I'm citing here. So you first have the first descent here, but then comes the second, the double descent. And what is happening here is, this is what Misha Belkin always calls the interpolation regime, because you have a function class that really interpolates your data, meaning you have training error zero. So interpolation is if you try to find a function that exactly goes through the data points that you're given. This is what happens in neural networks. And then you can observe in practice that for some algorithms you have this double descent. Of course, this is not true for whatever kind of algorithm you could come up with. There are a lot of algorithms for which this curve keeps on increasing. But there are algorithms out there, and among them deep networks, where you can observe this phenomenon. And now the idea is, so what is going on here? So here we are in this regime where the size of the function class is exponential. So learning theory would tell you you can't, like if you just do empirical risk minimization in this particular mode, in this particular regime of your space, of your function space, and just pick any function that has approximation, like has estimate training error zero, then you're going to overfit. And this statement is still true. But now what happens is, I mean, of course, like a function like a deep network doesn't go out and look at the function space and do empirical risk minimization in the sense that it just picks any function that has training error zero. There are many, many, many functions that have training error zero because the capacity is so large. And what happens now is deep network use a particular optimization algorithm, namely stochastic gradient descent with lots of heuristics and so on, to pick their function. And the conjecture that is currently out there is that the way in which this optimization works by some magic achieves that the function that is being picked by the deep network is a function that still generalizes. And so this is not a contradiction to learning theory. Learning theory just says, I mean, there are many functions out there which would be really bad. And if you pick any function which has a zero training error, most of them would be really, really bad and we don't have generalization. And the statement is now, yes, that's true. But the successful algorithms have some particular way of picking a function. And it is pretty much unclear still what this way is. But for some secret hidden secret, they manage to pick a function that has zero training error and is good. And so looking at it from a capacity point of view, it says even though the space has a huge capacity, the actual capacity of the space of function that the algorithm is actively considering is much, much, much smaller. Because by stochastic gradient descent, you wouldn't be able to achieve many of these functions. It's just a small subset of space of functions in your space that could potentially be picked, say by stochastic gradient descent, and this is why it might still work again. And some first results have been proved in also about certain function spaces and optimization algorithms, at least in simplistic regimes, where you can prove that this is really the case. And now, of course, the question is, can you prove it for deep networks or for which deep networks and so on? And what are the kind of quantities that really control it? Is it really the key that we use stochastic gradient descent, or what are really the key ingredients? Something like in learning, like in the statistical regime for support vector machine, like one of the key things is the margin, or for kernels, there are certain, like if you have a universal kernel, that's very important. So what are sort of the kind of quantities that are really the key thing that we need to make these deep networks successful? So this is a really, really interesting area of research, and it's still widely open.